So, good evening, everyone, and thank you all for joining quick early for this amazing session, which is being planned, that is answering the million-dollar question, what to use when in Azure. And I would like to welcome our today's speaker, Mr. Barry. He's a Microsoft MVP and Pluralsight author, and like I do follow him from long time for all the Azure updates and news, and it's just amazing. So, and I really thankful to Barry for considering my request for presenting this session for our dear Azure and AZ India community. So I will not take much time. I know everyone is quite interested in listening to Barry. So Barry, all over to you.
All right. Well, thank you very much. That's a very kind introduction, and thank you for having me here. I hope everyone can see the slides that I've shared, and I hope everyone can hear me all right.
So, yes, Barry, it's loud and clear. Thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah. Oh, that's perfect. All right. So yes, I'm Barry. You can find me on Twitter at Azure Barry and at azureberry.com. And I'm a software architect and developer. And I also create, next slide, Pluralsight courses. I've been quite busy with that, actually. I've done a bunch about Microsoft Azure, obviously, but also other ones about HTML and CSS and JavaScript. And I'm currently working on the last one in this list, and that's Microsoft Azure Developer, creating and implementing a detailed design for your solution, which is such a long title, but it's gonna be a great, great course. Takes a lot of work, but it's lots of fun. So today we are going to talk about which service to use in Azure when. And that's kind of a topic that relates to the Pluralsight course, Microsoft Azure for Developers, what to use when. So I encourage you to go to that course as well on Pluralsight and see what that's all about, because there I talk about way more categories than we have time for today. And there I go through all of the services that are important for developers in Microsoft Azure, and I talk about when to use which service there. So normally I do a survey. Sorry for that. These are obviously slides that I also use at conferences. Today we're not going to do a survey, but because I'm sure that this very targeted audience, of course, is all using Microsoft Azure. And by the way, first of all, I just want to thank everybody to join this session on a Sunday. That's pretty awesome. So you guys are obviously very interested in learning Azure. And that's, I find that just great, because obviously I teach a lot about Azure, and I always find it very great when people are very actively learning Azure, because I think Azure is awesome and it can do a lot for you that you would normally do yourself. And it takes away a lot of the hurdles for software development. You know, normally we would build and create everything ourselves, but now we can just use things from Azure, and that's just awesome. All right. So first of all, let's talk about why you should know what to use when. Well, it seems obvious, but let's just go through it. Well, that is because Azure is just incredibly huge, as you know. I have this website. It's called azureoverview.com. And there I keep track of all of the Azure services that are out there and their status. So are they in public preview, or are they generally available? And what is the service, so that you can click through and go to more documentation about it. I use this website myself also to just keep up to date, because that's the challenge with Azure, isn't it? Keeping up to date, because it's so incredibly big and there are so many services. There's lots of stuff there. Well, you all know it. There's app services, Logic Apps, Cosmos DB, Redis, Active Directory, cloud services, application insights, data, AI, machine learning, Kubernetes is hot now, container instances, all sorts of container options, event hubs, notification hubs, cognitive services, you name it. Azure is just incredibly huge. There are over 90 services or so. Not all are interesting for developers. Some are more for the IT pro side of things. But still, it is incredibly huge, and it changes very fast as well. So why should you know what to use when? Well, to make the right decisions for your requirements, obviously, but also to inspire you to adopt new services instead of building something yourself. Because maybe you didn't know that a service was there that did a particular thing that you needed for your application. And maybe you were planning to then build that yourself from scratch, but it is in Azure already. So if you know what to use when and which services are in Azure, then you also know that you then don't have to build that all yourself, but just use that as a service or as a platform as a service and just use it in your application instead of building it yourself. And that means that you can focus more on the actual business logic of the application and the added value that you have. So lots of services in Azure and more to come as well, because as you probably are aware of, from Monday until I think it's the whole week, it's Microsoft Ignite next week. And I'm sure there's lots and lots of new developments there and new services and new features in Azure. So that's always a challenge also, because then I need to update everything, all of the courses and all of these slides. All right, so let's dive into this. Today we're going to talk about what to use when for two major categories of services. And the first one is the category of services where you run your application in Azure, and there's are 11 services to choose from. And the second category is for storing your data in Azure, and we have 13 services to choose from for there. So lots of options if you want to do either of these things. So let's dive into it. Let's see what the options are in Azure for running your applications. Well, there are lots, let me tell you. You can run your application in a virtual machine. Well, you all know this, it's lift and shift. You just run it in a virtual machine. It's not really making a lot of use of the cloud, but you know, you're in the cloud. You can also use Azure Kubernetes Service, which is container-based, container instances. We have web apps for containers, also another container option. We have Azure Batch for hyperscale computing. We have Service Fabric. We have cloud services. We have Azure App Services web apps, Azure App Services mobile apps. We have Azure App Services function apps, or Azure Functions, and Azure Logic apps. So lots of services to choose from if you want to run your application. So how do you go about choosing which one is right for your application? Well, one way to categorize these services is by the amount of control that you have versus the time that you spend on adding business value to your application. So what I do is divvy them up into categories. So these ones, so virtual machines, containers, and also Azure Batch, and for a part also Service Fabric, are what I think is infrastructure as a service. And that means that you have a lot of control over these services, but also means that you have lots of responsibilities with these services. So for instance, with a VM, you have lots of control over the operating system and even over the network that the thing is in, but you're also responsible for the operating system. So you're also responsible for making sure that the operating system is up to date. So that's a trade-off right there. The second category is platform as a service, or PaaS. And those are cloud services, the old school cloud services, but also app services, web apps, which you can use to host a website in or an API, and the mobile apps as well. And here again, also partly Service Fabric, because I think Service Fabric you can use in two ways, and we're going to dive into that a little bit more. One way is to use it as platform as a service, where you just give it something to run and it just runs it without you having to worry about how it runs it. But you can also use it as a container orchestrator, where you have a lot more control, but you also have a lot more responsibilities there. And then the last category is logic as a service. I call it logic as a service. It's also called serverless, but I just don't like that word. It's hyped up way too much. And logic as a service just seems more sensible to me. And those are things like logic apps, which is logic as a service, of course, and also Azure Functions or function apps, which are serverless. So the way to think about this is when you have more control, so when you look at infrastructure as a service, you have a lot more control over VMs and containers and things like that, but you're also responsible for all those things, which means you don't have all that time that you're responsible for antivirus and operating systems and network settings and all that stuff. You're not spending on adding business value to your application and doing the things that actually matter to you and your customer. So the farther right you go with Logic Apps, for instance, you spend all of your time basically on adding business value because you don't care where it runs or how it runs. Azure takes care of all of that stuff. You just create your business logic within a Logic App and it just runs. The same goes for an Azure function. You don't even care about the scaling of a function because it does that automatically. That's what Logic as a Service does for you. So this is a choice. So once you know where you fall within these categories, then you can move forward. For instance, you could say, well, I need a lot of control. So I probably need something like a container or something, and that falls into the category of infrastructure as a service. All right. Now, before we go further with looking at how to choose from these services, let's just dive into these services quickly to see what they are, actually. You're probably familiar with most of these services, but still, maybe I'll surprise you. Azure Virtual Machines. We probably all know them. We probably have all used them at one point or are still using them, of course. And it is a virtual machine as a service. It starts and stops in minutes. It's pretty quick in that way, but still it can take a couple of minutes to start and stop and scale there. And you have many images to choose from. From Azure, you can, for instance, spin up a Windows Server virtual machine, or even one with SQL Server on it, or with Windows, or with Linux, or what have you. Many, many images that are already in the store that you can just use out of the box. You can also import your own image, create your own image, and import it to Azure, and then use that to create many, many virtual machines from the same image. And you also have an option to bring your own license, like, for instance, your own SQL Server license that you can then use within the virtual machine. You have many sizes to choose from, and it seems like every day new sizes are available, from very, very tiny to extremely large. And these are virtual machines for general purpose, so just for a workstation, for instance, to GPUs, so graphical processing units that you can use to mine bitcoins or do other very compute intensive things like render images or videos, for instance. There's lots of configuration options when you have an Azure virtual machine, and that's the thing. When you have something in the cloud, you get a lot of advantages. Like, for instance, auto shutdown. You can say to it, well, I want you to shut down at 8 because then I stop working, and then you start up at 7 because then I start working as well, and that saves you money because then whilst you're not working, the thing is just shut off and then you pay a minimal amount for it. You can configure disks as well and networking as well, like virtual networks around it. This thing is up and running 99.95% of the time if you run multiple instances of it. So that means you have to run a minimum of 2 virtual machines for this SLA to happen. And then Microsoft makes sure that this thing stays up and running. Obviously, things sometimes go wrong, as you probably have noticed with the latest outage in central US. You know, that can just happen. Happens to everybody. Happens probably more if you run all your stuff in your own data center. But you know, now you have a good team to blame as well. You can point to Microsoft and they will solve it for you. Right, the next one is Azure Kubernetes Service. This used to be Azure Container Service, but now it is Azure Kubernetes Service. I'm sure some of you are using this for container orchestration. So this runs and orchestrates multiple containers. So use this when you have an application that consists out of multiple containers. Containers start and stop in seconds, as opposed to virtual machines that start and stop in minutes. So these things are way faster and more lightweight than virtual machines. It runs on Azure Container Service, that it still does. And it orchestrates using Kubernetes. That's the orchestration engine that you use to spin up new containers, scale containers, make sure that they can talk to each other, all those things. You can run Linux and Windows containers on Azure Kubernetes Service. So basically any kind of containers, as long as they are Docker-based. And you can use container images from Docker Hub or from Azure Container Registry, which is also a service in Azure where you can host your own container images, or from anywhere else, really. Another container option is Azure Container Instances. And this runs single containers, so as opposed to Azure Kubernetes Service, which you use when you have multiple containers in your application. You use container instances to just run a single container. This also starts and stops in seconds because it is a container. And you don't need an orchestrator, but you can use one. You can hook this up to Kubernetes, for instance, or another container orchestrator if you want to. It also runs Linux and Windows containers. And as with Kubernetes service, you can use images from Docker Hub as your container registry or basically anywhere else. Excuse me, just took a sip because all that talking makes me thirsty. So another container option, we have lots of container options, is Azure Web App for containers. So that is Azure App Services Web Apps for containers. This means that you can run a container on app services, just like an app services web app or mobile app. Containers, again, start and stops in seconds. And you don't need an orchestrator for this because this is kind of like container instances where you just run one container. It runs Linux containers. And the last time I checked, it was Windows containers in preview, but it could be that that's also already in general availability. Eventually, this thing will obviously also run Linux and Windows containers. The difference that this thing has from container instances is that this uses app services features. So things like easy continuous deployment, that you can hook this thing up to GitHub or another repository. And then when you push a change, it just updates whatever is in the container in the web app. You have deployment slots, so staging ability. You have automatic scaling with scaling rules where you can say, well, when the CPU hits 80%, then I want another instance. Well, the person that I think just joined, please mute their microphone. Yeah, thank you. And with this also, you can use images from Docker Hub as your container registry or anywhere else, really. Then there is Azure Batch. And Azure Batch runs your job across many virtual machines. So you can submit a job, a computation job, for instance, to Azure Batch. And then it can run that on many virtual machines. So Azure Batch then takes that job and scales it out onto many virtual machines. And that is hyperscale computing there. You could, for instance, use this to render a very large movie file. I know they do this at Universal sometimes. They use Azure Batch for that as well. And then they just get this big movie file, and then they have a job that can render that movie file, just some logic that can do that. And then Azure Batch takes care of divvying that up over many, many virtual machines. And that means that you can then minimize your time doing that. Because if they did that with one machine, for instance, one big machine, then it might take days or maybe a week to render this. But if you can scale this across many, many virtual machines, then you could be done in hours. Now, obviously, you pay for that as well, but then that's the choice that you have. So it orchestrates running your job. You obviously need to create your job yourself, and Azure Batch takes care of the orchestration for it. And then it scales that across machines. It can also stage data for your job. So if you have, for instance, one big movie file that you need to process, then you can use Azure Batch to cut that data up into pieces and have all those pieces processed separately on their own virtual machines. And you can create job pipelines with tasks and create a process that Azure Batch uses. You can run your job on Windows or Linux virtual machines. And Azure Batch can also run containers. So it's also another container option. We have lots of container options. So you could provide Azure Batch with a container that contains your job with whatever technology that uses. And then Azure Batch just executes that over many, many virtual machines if you need to. And then there is Azure Service Fabric. And that is, this thing can run your applications reliably and resilient. that is very generic, obviously. So this thing orchestrates running your application. It keeps it available. It keeps it performant by scaling, performs rolling upgrades, and it does lots more things. And this thing is also used by many services that are already in Azure. Like for instance, Azure SQL databases runs on Azure Service Fabric. So Microsoft uses Azure Service Fabric themselves to run their stuff on high scale, high availability, and do things like rolling upgrades. But now you can use it yourself by using this service. And what this can run is basically anything. It can run any executable. It's called a guest executable when you do that. It can also run reliable services that you create with the Azure Service Fabric API. And you can also create actor-based applications like Akka.net applications, for instance. And you can also feed it containers, and then it can orchestrate containers. It doesn't use Kubernetes or anything like a container orchestrator. It is its own container orchestrator. So it can basically run anything, really. It runs in the cloud and also on premises. And that is very important because you can install Azure Service Fabric, the runtime, anywhere on your own laptop, on a server in your own data center, or in another cloud, for instance. Or you can use it as a service in Azure itself. You do need quite a large setup for production to actually get an SLA there. You need a minimum of 5 virtual machines. And it needs that to make sure that everything can stay available and that it can perform rolling upgrades and that everything runs redundant. And then there is Azure Cloud Services. And these are very old. They run your app in virtual machines as web or worker roles. And this was one of the first platform as a service services in any cloud, really, obviously also in Azure. This service abstracts the virtual machine so that you don't have to deal with it. So basically, you just feed it whatever it is that you want to run, like a website, for instance, or a background job. And then it just runs that on a VM, and you don't have to deal with the VM. Azure makes sure that the VM runs, and it makes sure that the operating system gets updated. It provides scaling, and it does a lot more for you. You just package up your app, and you deploy it to Azure Cloud Services. It is a bit of an old school service. I personally don't use it anymore if I have the choice. I would prefer then to use a web app, for instance. So you can use it to run as an HTTP-based application or to run as a background job, so the web and the worker roles. And it enables you to have some control over the VM. And that's the difference that you have with web apps, where it's a little bit more abstracted, where you don't have a VM to RDP into to troubleshoot. But then again, do you really need that? I don't think so. All right. And then there's what I just talked about, the Azure App Services web app. This is a very popular service, obviously. And you can use it to run your application in a web server as a service. This is basically IIS running in the cloud or PHP Tomcat running in the cloud. You can even run Java in there as well. See, Node.js and Python, whatever. It's just a web server as a service. But it comes with additional features because you are running it in the cloud. That gives you lots of advantages, like continuous deployment, like we talked about in an earlier service as well, where you can hook up GitHub, for instance. Custom domains, deployment slots, automatic scaling, authentication, authorization, that's being made easy. Web jobs as well to run background jobs on this. And you can have hybrid connections to on-premises resources. So you can create a hybrid connection, and then you can use that with your Azure App Services. For instance, you can create a connection to a SQL database that runs on-premises within your own data center. And then you can have Azure App Services web app from Azure talk to your data center, to your SQL server there, which is pretty cool. This thing stays up and running 99.95% of the time when you have one running. You don't need two for this. Microsoft just makes sure that it keeps running, and it does that very well. Then there are Azure App Services web jobs, and you use these to run your background tasks in App Services. This runs inside your app service, so you can run it in the context of a web app, for instance, or a mobile app, or in its own app service plan as well. If you do run it inside the context of web app, this thing, this job also consumes the same resources as the web app. So that's something to consider. This thing can be triggered by all sorts of things, like on a schedule every day at 8, for instance, or by outside resources, like when a new message comes in on a queue, for instance. The web job gets triggered and then it does its work. All right, another member of the app services family is the Azure App Services mobile app. And you use this to run your app as a backend for mobile clients. So when you have a mobile client, an app running on your mobile device, you need a backend often, an API or something that your app can talk to. And that API, you host that in App Services mobile apps. You can run .NET and Node.js APIs in this service. And mobile clients, so applications on the mobile device, connect to the service through the SDK. And the SDK is available for all sorts of platforms, like for iOS, Android, Windows, Xamarin, Forms, basically anything. This thing has some unique features, like the ability to do offline synchronization. So when your application on your mobile device is offline for a little bit, then you can just continue working and the application stores the changes in a SQLite database that's on the device. And once you get back online, it just syncs all of those changes back to the backend API. It also does push notifications to all sorts of platforms, and it has all of the app services features like deployment slots, automatic scaling, and the easy authentication and authorization. And it also stays up and running 99.95% of the time. And the last member of the Azure App Services family is the App Services Function app, also known as Azure Functions. It is a member of the App Services family because it can run in an app service plan. And you use this to execute small pieces of code. So a small piece of code that you write, you just chuck that in here and it just runs. It can be triggered just like a web job on a schedule or by an outside resource, like by a webhook, for instance, or a new message in a queue. And it can also have bindings where an incoming Azure blob value, for instance, when it is triggered by something that has a blob value, the function app gets the value of the blob without you having to write the code to connect to blob storage. Or an outgoing Azure storage queue message, where you need to write a queue message out. You can just create a binding to the Azure storage queue, and you don't have to create all of those that code to actually connect to Azure storage queues, which is amazing because that means that you can just focus on whatever you need the job to run, to do, the function to do. So this is maximum value where you actually write the business value, you add the value that adds value to your company or to your customer, and Azure takes care of the rest. This also has all of the app service features, like deployment slots and easy authentication authorization. And this is serverless as it can run in consumption mode, which means that you pay only for the execution. So when this thing runs, you pay for it. And it also scales automatically. So you don't have to create scaling rules or make sure that it is scalable somehow. It just scales. So when more triggers come in, for instance, or when more processing power is needed, Azure just spins up more function instances. You also pay for those, but they are very, very cheap. Then the final one is Azure Logic Apps. You use this to execute a pipeline of tasks within a process. This is basically the replacement for BizTalk services. You have BizTalk on-premises, the server variant, and there used to be also Azure BizTalk services, which was then the BizTalk, the Azure's variant of BizTalk server. That doesn't exist anymore. Now, if you need to do any process orchestration or integration, you use an Azure Logic app. This can also be triggered on a schedule or by an outside resource, by like a webhook or a new message in a cloud, just like a function app can, or a webhook, a web job can as well. And then you follow the whole process. This thing can then call connectors in steps. There are countless connectors to resources like Office 365, Twitter, SendGrid, your own APIs, many, many other services that are out of the box, or in the box, better said, that you can just use. So you could very easily, for instance, create a process that is triggered when you receive an email from Office 365. And then the next step could be that you filter out some text from the email, and then you do something with it and send a tweet, let's say. That's very easy to create. And this only runs in consumption mode, so only runs serverless. That means that it scales automatically, and also that you only pay for when it runs, which is very amazing. All right, so that was a lot of services, 11, I think it was. So let's just see again. Here are all these services again. So we just categorize them into categories, as in infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and logic as a service. So once you've made that choice, so how much control do you need versus how much business value you want to be able to create, you can move on to next choices. For instance, if you need full control and responsibility, like we talked about, but you also need to stay vendor agnostic, as in you want your service to be able to run anywhere. So not only in Azure, but also maybe in Amazon Cloud, Google Cloud, or maybe on-premises, then these are your options. So virtual machines, because you can create a virtual machine image and run that anywhere. The container options as well, like container instances and batch that runs containers, and web app for containers, because containers run anywhere, really. You can run it locally on your local machine, in another server, or in another cloud, wherever. And also service fabric, when you use containers. That's also an option here. And with containers, you also have full control and responsibilities, because containers are infrastructure as a service. You know, you are responsible for the container image, so also responsible for updating it. So you want Azure to manage your application, so you want less control, and you manage the scaling and configuration. You do that yourself, and configuration is then the application configuration, as in which version of .NET do you run, and do you run 32 or 64 bits, things like that. Then these are your options. Again, Azure Batch, but now not when running containers, but more when you are running regular jobs, but also cloud services, mobile apps, web apps, and service fabric when not using containers. So these options, just run your app. You just say Azure, run my app, and do it. I don't want to see the operating system. I don't want to be responsible for the antivirus and updating all that. I just want to be responsible for scaling and configuring my application. And now when you want to be able to RDP into a VM, so have a little bit more control, then these are your options. Cloud services run on virtual machines. Basically everything does, but still cloud services is an abstraction over virtual machines, and you can still RDP into a virtual machine. So you can diagnose stuff, but you can also install custom things there. Azure Batch is the same thing. It also runs on virtual machines. Service Fabric as well, it runs on a virtual machine set, which you can control, because you can just RDP into that and control the virtual machines or see what's going wrong. And next, when you want Azure to manage your application, including the scaling, you just don't care at all how it works. Just run my app, I'll just pay for it, whatever. But you do manage the configuration, of course, because you do want to manage what it runs and which versions and stuff, and also the connection strings and all those settings. Then these are your options, logic apps and functions, or function apps, because these things scale by themselves because they are serverless. You only pay for them when they are used, and you just configure them basically and run your code in them. In a logic app, you can code in JSON, but you just configure the process basically in a GUI. With a function app, you do write your code, but that's minimal, and you just configure it and it runs. So those are your options. Now let's compare some things, because we've seen a bunch of categories as well, like container options and VMs. Let's just put these side by side. So comparing container options and virtual machines. We have a virtual machine, container instances, Kubernetes service, web apps for containers, Azure Batch, and Service Fabric. All of these can run containers, orchestrate containers, or are a VM. So when you want to lift and shift your application to the cloud, then a VM is a great option because it is simple. You know, usually you are already running your application within a server context, and now you can do exactly the same. You can create the exact same server, but then in Azure with Linux or whatever operating system you're running, and just run your application there. So this is a great way to get into the cloud, to start with the cloud. Now, if you want to run a very simple application without an orchestrator, then a VM is an option, because you can run whatever you want in a VM, also very, very simple application. But also container instances are an option, because you just run one container in container instances, and you don't need a container orchestrator. You can use one, but you don't need it. When you need a more complex application with an orchestrator, you run that with Kubernetes service, because it is a container orchestrator, or within Service Fabric, because it also can orchestrate your containers. When you want to run orchestrated microservices, so many services, maybe all within their own containers, for instance, you can do that with Service Fabric. It's much more geared towards microservices than Kubernetes currently is, at least in my opinion. I see a question there. What is an orchestrator? I've just talked about container orchestrators in a couple of slides back. And that is a service like Kubernetes, for instance, that is a container orchestrator. And that thing can manage containers for you. It can orchestrate them. And what that means is that it can start containers, stop containers, create new containers, get rid of containers, make sure that all of your containers are healthy and can talk to each other. So it takes care of all of your containers. That's the orchestrator. So what I was saying, in my opinion, Service Fabric at the moment is better geared towards running microservices than Kubernetes is in this case, because Service Fabric also provides some additional features to run microservices that Kubernetes doesn't have. When you want to run anywhere, so not only in Azure, but also on other clouds or on-premises, for instance, then Service Fabric is your man, because you can install it anywhere, on your own laptop if you want to. The other services only run within the cloud, within Azure. When you run web apps, a web app on Linux with app service features, which is a very specific scenario, obviously, then you can use web apps for containers. And finally, when you need to run repetitive jobs on massive scale, then you do that within Azure Batch. All right. So where to run your background tasks? We saw another question. Can we deploy a Windows service in a Docker container? Oh, that's interesting. Yeah. Yes, of course. Yeah, you could. Because you can basically create anything in a container. You would just have to, in this case, a Windows service. You would run a Windows server in a Docker container, a Windows server image in a container, and just run that server. That's fine, because basically a container is a virtual machine. It's just a bit smaller and more lightweight, and it can start and stop in seconds. So yeah, you can do that if you want to. So that's a good segue to this bit. A Windows service is also a background task, and we've already seen lots of options to run background tasks. So let's compare those. We have cloud services, web jobs, functions, Azure Batch, and that's it. Yeah. So when you want to run short running tasks, so things that don't run that long, you can do that in cloud services, web jobs, functions, and as well. So in anything. You want to run long running tasks, you can also do that in cloud services, because it runs in app services, and that can run however long it wants to. You can do that in a web job. Web jobs run in app services. Cloud services obviously don't. Sorry. And that can run as long as you want. But also Azure Functions. You can also use that to run long-running tasks. It used to be that an Azure Function just cuts off your task after 5 minutes. But if you run an Azure Function in an app service plan, so not serverless, you can run it for as long as you want. It just means that you pay for it all month instead of pay for it only when it runs. And you can also do that in Azure Batch. So another question here, is it possible to host SSAS, multi-dimensional model on container services, mainly Azure Kubernetes services. It's possible. It's definitely possible because you basically can run anything on a container service. But I don't know if it is recommendable in there. I would go more for like a managed service in this case. So SSAS, SQL Server Analysis Services Multidimensional Model, is what the questionnaire is talking about. You could maybe also run that on Azure Analysis Services, because that's basically SQL Server Analysis Services as a managed service in the cloud. So if you can run it there, that would be my recommendation instead of running it in a container. But it could be that you need more control, and then you probably need a container. Yeah, it could be. So yes, it's possible, but I would definitely take a look at if you can run it in something else like Azure Analysis Service. And no, we are not going to talk about Azure Redis Cache. So another question is, can you please elaborate more on Azure Redis Cache service? We're not going to talk about caching in this webinar. You could take a look at one of my latest Pearlsight courses that talks about caching and then Redis Cache in that case. All right, I need to get on. So long-running tasks we can also do in all of the services. So if you want a particularly resource-intensive task, so something that, for instance, renders a movie file, then Azure Batch is your thing, because it then takes that task and runs it over multiple virtual machines and scales out. If you want to pay for something all month, then you could choose a cloud service, web job. Yeah, and that's it. If you want to pay only for what and when you run, then a function is a good idea, because you can run that in consumption mode, so serverless, where you only pay for when it runs. And Azure Batch as well, because Azure Batch does use VMs, and VMs typically are things that you pay for all month, but you only spin up these VMs when you actually execute the job on Azure Batch, and then the VMs can go away again. All right. If you need to deploy a complete application to run, then you have a cloud service where in Visual Studio, for instance, you create a complete application, you package that up within a cloud service project, and then you deploy that to the cloud service enabled to run. Batch does the same thing. You need to create a complete job in Visual Studio as well, that you then take into Azure Batch, and then it can run. But if you, on the other hand, only deploy the code that is necessary to run, so a small piece of code that doesn't have all of the plumbing code, let's say, to run, you can do that in web jobs and also in Azure Functions, because those things are take care of more than cloud services and batch do for you. So another question is, if it is a long-running job, Azure Functions normally times out. Is there a way to increase timeout to infinite? What is the proposed solution for this? So yes, you can run Azure Functions in two modes. So one is a consumption mode, and then it will time out. If you have something that it doesn't like, it runs too long or it consumes too many resources. But you can also run it in app service mode, where you just run it as an Azure app service. So it basically is like an Azure web app in that case. That means that you pay for it all month, but then it can run indefinitely, infinite, basically. It doesn't really have that that timeout that you are experiencing now. So you could switch to there. I don't think you can switch with an existing Azure function, so you'd have to create a new one for that. All right, let's move on. So where to run your application, last category. So we have web apps, mobile apps, cloud services, service fabric, Azure Functions, and logic apps. So when you want to host a web application, you can do that in a web app, in cloud service as well, in web roles, and in service fabric as well, because you can run anything there. When you want to host your own APIs, you can do that in a web app and in the cloud service and also in service fabric. Notice here that I don't mention App Services API apps. That's also an option that exists, but it doesn't have any unique features. It's the exact same thing as an Azure web app. I've asked Microsoft about this many, many times, and what they say is that, well, it is just another icon that you then have in the Azure portal so that you can distinguish, well, this thing runs an API instead of a website, let's say. So my recommendation is to just use an Azure web app also for that, because probably API apps will go away in at some point. Oh, and also Azure Functions, you can definitely use those to host your own APIs, because that means that you can have your code just function as an API. Yes, and I saw another question there, if I can share the link of the Redis cache video. Definitely, I will do that. So if you want to host backend for mobile apps, we talked about this, then you use the App Services mobile app. And if you want to automate one step of a process, so for instance, the sending of an email, then Azure Functions is your best bet. And if you want to automate a complete process, so multiple steps, then you do that with a logic app. And a logic app can then also call functions. If you want to enjoy features like deployment slots, easy authentication, continuous integration, all that stuff, App Services is your best bet. So web apps, and mobile apps in that case, and also functions. Oh, and cloud services also. Yeah, that's right. Because they also have deployment slots, but they don't have all of the features that App Services do. And if you want to run microservices at massive scale, we just saw that as well, then Service Fabric is your best bet. You can also do that with Azure Functions, because you can have them run as APIs, but scaling those and moreover orchestrating those is difficult, but technically you can do it. All right, that was the first category. That was a lot of stuff. Let's go on to the next category. And don't worry, I'm going to make it with the time because this is smaller. So now we're going to talk about the options in Azure for storing your data. So there are 13, I think. There's Azure SQL Database, Azure Database for MySQL, for PostgreSQL, for MariaDB. There's Cosmos DB. There's Azure Storage. There's Azure File Storage, which all falls within Azure Storage. Files, blobs, queues, tables, and disks as well. Where we don't talk about queues right now, because yes, you can store data in queues, but it's not really a storage service. It's more of an eventing service. It's a queue. You can also store data in Azure SQL Data Warehouse for big data, and also Azure Data Lake Store, also for bigger data. Well, one way of categorizing these, so to make your choice, which one do you need to use for your application, is to take a look at the type of data that you have. You already saw the slide. So for instance, if you need to store relational data, you can do that in Azure SQL Database and all of the Azure databases for MySQL, PostgreSQL, and MariaDB. If you need to store unstructured or document data, so documents, for instance, you can use Cosmos DB. It has lots of storage types, but they're all document and unstructured, or Azure Storage as well, like files or blobs or whatever in a table, for instance. And if you need to do data analytics later on, you can store your data in Azure SQL Data Warehouse or Data Lake Store, because they are best suited for that purpose. All right, let's go into the options in more detail. And I'll go a bit more quickly to keep on the time. Data Factory, yeah, that's a good question. So the question is, what about Data Factory? Well, Data Factory is also a data-related service, but you don't use it to store data in. You use it to move data around and to transform it whilst you're moving it around. So it's more of an eventing service than actually a data storage service. All right, Azure SQL Databases. This is basically SQL Server in the cloud. You probably all know this service. It's managed by Azure and it's scalable. It's highly available by default, and it stores relational data. You can use this with Microsoft tools like SQL Server Management Studio, Azure Portal, Visual Studio, and it has advanced capabilities. Because it runs in the cloud, you get some advantages, like geo-replication, where you can replicate your Azure SQL database to another geographical region. Also automatic tuning, where it can automatically create indexes for you when you miss some to increase performance. Also threat detection as well, and dynamic data masking, which can show you different data based upon your access level. So for instance, if you don't have access to the credit card data, you might just see some scrambled numbers. There is Azure databases for MySQL, which is, well, MySQL in the cloud, basically. It's managed and scalable, just like Azure SQL is, highly available and redundant, and you also use it to store relational data. This works well in the LAMP stack, which stands for Linux, Apache, MySQL, and PHP. So more of an open source stack. You use it with tools for MySQL, so not SQL Server Management Studio, but other tools like MySQL Workbench and SQL Yog. And then there is Azure Database for PostgreSQL, and that's PostgreSQL in the cloud, of course. It's also managed and scalable, highly available and redundant, and it also stores relational data. It is flexible as well, because you can write functions for it in several languages. And you can use PostgreSQL extensions. So these features are unique to Postgres, and MySQL, for instance, doesn't have those. And SQL, Azure SQL databases, also doesn't have those. And you use it with tools for PostgreSQL, so also not with SQL Server Management Studio, but with things like pgAdmin, which are very specific tools for this database. And then there is Azure databases for MariaDB. And this is MariaDB in the cloud, and because it runs in Azure, it's managed and scalable and highly available, and it also stores relational data. And it supports many storage engines, which means that you can use Apache Cassandra as an API, CSV or column store as well. And this is then the unique feature of MariaDB. And you use it with tools for MariaDB, like Database Workbench and also SQL Yog, who works here as well. So not SQL Server Management Studio. These are all more open source type databases. And there is Azure Cosmos DB. A very exciting database. It's distributed massive scale database. So what does that mean? Well, it's a database that you can use with several APIs. So you can use a DocumentDB API, because it was called DocumentDB earlier on. I think it's now renamed to the SQL API, MongoDB API, Table API, Graph API, Apache Cassandra API. I think there's more coming as well. So this means that if your application uses a MongoDB database, for instance, you can just repoint that to Azure Cosmos DB, and then it uses that instead with the exact same commands and SDK. You don't need to predefine a schema for your data when you use Azure Cosmos DB. And it does automatic indexes as well. So this is really meant to just be a database as a service. You just put data in there, and it just makes sure that it's in some sort of schema, and it has an index, and it stays performant. It also does geo-replication, just like Azure SQL does, where you can replicate all of the contents of an Azure Cosmos DB instance to another geographical region. And it has a unique SLA, which means that it's up 99.99% of the time, just like Azure SQL and all the other databases. But for read, it is available 99.999% of the time, which is way more, which is very impressive. And it also promises that the latency on reads is always smaller than 10 milliseconds, and for writes, it's smaller than 15 milliseconds. So in the SLA, they promise this thing is going to be fast, and it's going to be highly available, which is cool. All right, then there is Azure Storage, and this is massive scale multi-purpose storage, and it contains multiple models where you can store your data in. So we have Azure File Storage, Blob Storage, Queue Storage, Table Storage, and this thing has features that all of these storage types share, like shared access signatures, which are things that you can use to access these storage types, firewalls and virtual networks that you can set up, data encryption at rest, storage replication, where you can have the storage contents replicate to another geographical region, for instance, for when a data center collapses. You can choose from locally redundant, where it just replicates data in its local data center, or geo-redundant, where it replicates to another geographical location, or even read access geo-redundant, and this is the most expensive option. And this means that it does replicate all of the data to another geographical region, and you can also read from that while it does it. This means that you can make more performant applications. All right, let's go through the storage types of Azure Storage. So there's Azure File Storage, which you can use to lift and shift files to the cloud. File storage is based on the SMB protocol. You can also use it to mount a disk to your Windows or Linux machine, for instance. Yeah, that's what I said. Mac OS even. And it also has all of the other Azure storage features like shared access signatures and, for instance, the redundancy features. I see a question, and that is, what is the difference between data storage and Cosmos DB? And I'll get to that later. All right. But if I don't, remind me. There's Azure Blob Storage as well. And you use this to store unstructured data in the cloud. So blobs of data, literally. And you have multiple blob types that you can store, like block blobs, page blobs, and append blobs. And those have all different properties that you can use to store your data. It also has multiple storage tiers. You have hot blobs, which you can access immediately and are very fast. And you also have cool blobs, which are a bit slower, but also means that you pay less for them. So cool data that you don't use that much. And you even have archive blobs, which means those are things that you just need to store for instance, the tax agency for 5 years or something, but you really don't use them. You can just store them here, and it's also for minimal costs. And it also has all of the other Azure Storage features. Right, then there's Azure Table Storage, which you use to store semi-structured data in the cloud. So not completely structured or relational like in a SQL table, but semi-structured. So that means that we have a flexible data schema. So we do create a table where we have columns in the table, but every row in the table can have different columns. It's flexible. It does also have all of the other storage features, Azure storage features like shared access signatures. And there's Azure Disk Storage, which is kind of like Azure File Storage, but it is high performance file storage in the cloud. So it's more performant than Azure File Storage. And you use that for virtual machines, for instance, where you need to run things like SQL Server in a virtual machine, for instance. It's part of the premium pricing tier. And you use it to lift and shift not files, but high performance applications like SQL Server to the cloud. And it also has all of the other Azure storage features. And then there is Azure SQL Data Warehouse. And you use this for prepared structured data for reporting. So you can store relational data in this. It's basically SQL Server, but then optimized for data analytics. And it's optimized for reporting purposes. So its performance and everything around it is optimized for this purpose. You use it for large amounts of data. You can store to up to 1 petabyte of data in there. It does things like data encryption at rest with transparent data encryption and has other advanced features as well. And then the next big data store is the Azure Data Lake Store. And you use this for structured and unstructured data for reporting. Data, you store data here in its native format. So it doesn't matter how it comes in, you just store it into Data Lake Store. Unlike in Azure SQL Data Warehouse, which we just talked about, you don't have to create a schema up front. You just chuck this in there and then you see later what you're going to do with it. You'll process it later. So no schema definition, and it's also optimized for reporting purposes. And unlike SQL Data Warehouse, this basically has no file or data store size limits. It's limited by your credit card, basically. So you can store whatever you want in there. It also has data encryption at rest. Yeah. So lots of options that you can use to store data in Azure. We've all seen these. So we've seen that you can categorize these into the type of data, relational or unstructured, that you can use. But there's another categorization that you can use as well. So you can categorize these in data stores for online transactional processing, or OLTP, which is the type of data store that you use for applications. So for instance, when you use an Azure SQL database, with your website. That's online transactional processing. The other type is online analytical processing, so OLAP, which is the type of data store that you use when you store data just for analytical processes. So not for when you use it with an application, but for analytical processes. All right, so now let's use those categories to go through these data stores, and then I will get to the questions, including to the data storage and Cosmos DB question. So let's take a look at the OLTP options. We have SQL, MySQL, PostgreSQL, MariaDB, Cosmos DB, and all of the Azure storage options. I've just chucked those all under this this category here. So when you want to store relational data, you use either SQL, MySQL, PostgreSQL, or MariaDB. When you want to store semi or non-relational data, so for instance, files or objects, you use Cosmos DB or any of the Azure storage types. When you want to use Microsoft tools to manage your storage service in the cloud, you can use SQL for SQL Server Management Studio, for instance, or Cosmos DB as well with the Azure Storage Explorer and also Visual Studio, and also Azure Storage. If you want advanced querying capabilities, then you can use SQL, MySQL, PostgreSQL, MariaDB, DB, but not Azure Storage, because Azure Storage is a much more simple storage mechanism. So you can query Azure Storage, but you can only do very simple queries to Azure Storage. And also the line just before this, so can you use Microsoft tools to manage it? For SQL, you can. For Cosmos DB, you can. And for storage as well. But for the other tools, you really use the tools that are specific for those, which are usually open source tools. So for instance, the MySQL option, PostgreSQL, and MariaDB, you would use those if you would already use those within your application and you want to lift and shift those to the cloud, if you're comfortable with those. For the other part, there's not much difference between those and, for instance, Azure SQL databases. So if you want to use multiple APIs to be able to access your data, then you can do that with Cosmos DB, where we saw that you can use Apache Cassandra, the table storage API, MongoDB API, DocumentDB API, you name it. So, excuse me, just a sip of water. So for the question about what the difference is between data storage, I think that's Azure Storage and the Cosmos DB, or Cosmos DB you can also use for semi or non-relational data, and you can use it with Microsoft tools and manage that the same as Azure Storage as well. Cosmos DB you use for more advanced things, so you can use it to do advanced querying on it because it is a very advanced database, where Azure Storage is much more primitive. So you use that for more simple data, and Cosmos DB more for more complex data. That's, in my opinion, the difference there. All right. So I'm just going to finish up this comparison as well, and then I'm going to take a look at the other questions and get to those as well, if you guys want to hang out with me whilst I do that. So let's compare the next category of Azure Storage Services, and those are the Azure storage services as well. So within Azure storage, we have Azure file storage, blob storage, table storage, disk storage, and also queue, and we're not gonna do that. So files, if you want to lift and shift files to the cloud, you use Azure file storage because it acts as an SMB file storage mechanism that you can also mount to your server or to your computer itself. If you want to lift and shift applications to the cloud, so not only files, but the complete application, then you can use Azure Disk Storage because that is premium file storage that is much, much faster. And you can use, for instance, to run Azure SQL on or a SQL applications on. If you need to store large unstructured data, then you use Azure Blob Storage because you can put just blobs in there. And those blobs can be very large. They can be gigabytes large. If you want to store smaller semi-structured data, like in the form of key value pairs or rows of data, than you use Azure Table Storage. So let's compare the OLAP options, which is Azure SQL Data Warehouse and Azure Data Lake Store. So if you want to store relational data for analytical purposes, you do that in Azure SQL Data Warehouse, but you can also do that in Azure Data Lake Store, because it doesn't really matter what you store in there. If you want to store non-relational data, you can't do that in Azure SQL Data Warehouse, but you can do that in Azure Data Lake Store. It stores anything, really. If you want a store that doesn't require you to define a data schema, you use Data Lake Store. I do it the other way around. And if you do want to define a schema upfront, then you use Azure Data SQL Data Warehouse, because it's basically Azure SQL databases, but optimized for analytic performance. And you don't do that in Azure Data Lake Store because you just store data in its native format there. If you need no file or database size limits, but just your credit card limits, then you use Azure Data Lake Store. And I think this is the main difference between these two services. You use it when you know which questions you want the data to answer. That is the Azure SQL Data Warehouse, because you create the schema upfront. You create a table basically upfront, so you know which data that you want to present to the user. And the user in this case is somebody that uses something like Power BI to actually analyze the data. And you can only do that when you know which questions that they want to answer there. If you don't know which questions that you want the data to answer, you just have a big bucket of data and you don't even know what's in there, then you use the Azure Data Lake Store, because you can process that. You don't have to create a schema upfront, which limits what you can answer with the data. And then you can go further and process that, and maybe later on even put it into Azure SQL Data Warehouse and get the questions answered there. So that's the main difference, I think, there. All right. So last few things before I go to the questions. So how do you stay up to date with all of this stuff? This is a lot of stuff, and these are just two categories. There are so many more categories of Azure services. So these are a couple of resources that I use to stay up to date within Azure. So I use the Azure Architecture Center, for instance, which is a website on Microsoft. I use Azure Friday as well, which is a show that Scott Hanselman does every, I think it does it now three times a week or something. It's not really on Friday anymore, but it discusses one Azure service. So somebody from the product team actually discusses what the service does and what it doesn't do, which is very helpful. Lots of blogs I follow, and obviously I also watch Pluralsight courses. So these are URLs and examples of blogs that I follow, for instance, and to Azure Friday as well. I'll make sure that you guys get these slides, so you don't have to take a screenshot or anything. You'll just get these slides so that you can click on this yourself. You can find me on Pluralsight. I have lots of courses on there as well. I'll also share the course about Azure Redis Cache as well with you guys, and find me there. All right, let's go to some questions. Let me just see about this. I have to scroll back because there's lots of questions, which is very good. You guys are very active. I like it a lot. Let's see. All right, the window keeps on going back to the latest question. Let's see. We've had the difference between this data storage and Cosmos DB already, where Cosmos DB can do much more complex queries. And the next question is there a way to read content of XLSX file stored on Blob through Azure Data Factory? Well, that's a great question. I don't know the answer to that. I do know that Azure Data Factory has lots of providers, so things out of the box that can connect to Azure Data Storage, for instance, and can then do things with them, analytical things. So there might be a provider out there that can read XLSX files, but my gut feeling says no, not out of the box, but you can write your own logic as well. So you can have a step within Azure Data Factory where you say, do this with the data that you get. So you can just write C# code or whatever to then read out the XLSX file that is in there and get the data that way. I think that's probably what you need to do, but hopefully for you, there is already an out-of-the-box step within Azure Data Factory. I would just Google it and you will find the answer. Next question is, can we have external tables in Azure Data Warehouse? If no, any option to refer to existing table without importing in Data Warehouse? Ah, right. I think I understand, yeah. So the ability to, for instance, link an external data table into Azure Data Warehouse. I think there is a capability to do that. I don't remember the name of the technology that they use. It is a Microsoft technology that is very prominently marketed with Azure Data Factory to do that. So yes, I do think that they do have that within Azure Data Warehouse. I haven't used that myself, I must say. But I do think it is in there. I don't know where it is exactly, so I would just try and look it up. Next question is, what is the main difference between Data Lake and Factory? So Data Lake and Data Factory. Well, I think the main difference is that Azure Data Lake itself is a data, this Data Lake store itself is a data storage service, where Azure Data Factory is a service that you use to move data and to transform it. So you can't store data in Azure Data Factory, you just use it to manipulate data. Azure Data Lake is something that you use to store data in. There's also Data Lake Analytics, just to make it a bit more complicated. And that is an analytics engine that you use together with Azure Data Lake. It has nothing to do with Data Factory, but that's another service that also contains the words Data Lake. All right, another question is, sorry for the long question, that's all right. Scaling is provided by cloud itself. Does it mean we shouldn't use Windows clustering? If not to use Windows clustering, then what is the role of a Windows cluster service in the cloud? And then I assume that you mean with this question that you would use Windows clustering within virtual machines that you then run in Azure. That's my assumption here. Correct me if I am wrong. If you want to scale virtual machines, then the best way is to do that using virtual machine sets, virtual machine scale sets, which is basically a wrapper around virtual machines within Azure that you can use to simply scale virtual machines. So you wouldn't need Windows clustering or anything like that. In that case, you just scale the virtual machine within there. It depends on what you want to scale. If you want to scale your application within the virtual machine, that's a different thing. So it depends. I would say look at virtual machine scale sets in this case. All right. And I see I had the same question. Another question is, what is Azure Databricks? And does HD Insight has Apache products? That's a great question. That's another category. Azure Databricks is also an analytical engine, just like HD Insight can provide as well. So HD Insight, Hadoop HD Insight, is a service that you can run in Azure, and you can choose to run a type of cluster of HD Insight within Azure. And you can, for instance, spin up an Apache Spark cluster, an HD Insight Apache Spark cluster within Azure, or all sorts of other Apache products within HD Insight that you can run. And the advantage that you have over creating those in a VM within Azure is that then the cluster is already configured and it is scalable and it is managed by Azure in that way. Now, Azure Databricks is also an analytical engine. It's fully managed by Azure. So it's a bit less complicated than HD Insight. And it also provides an Apache product. It provides Spark, Apache Spark, which you can use to analyze data with. But it also provides you with a collaboration space. And that's the main selling point of Azure Databricks. So you can use this to collaborate around data with your data scientists and developers. through a shared space, basically, that you use to use Azure Spark. So you have things like notebooks and things and shared queries that you can share around. And you can use this all together to use Apache Spark in that way. So it's another way to use Apache Spark than HD Insight is, and it's more managed, and it has a bunch more working together features in there. It is very complicated to separate these things. That is very true. So another question is it possible to create the asynchronous pipeline in Data Factory? Yes, it is possible to create an asynchronous data transformation pipeline in there. So for instance, when you want to move data from one place to another, and you want to do that with multiple data sources, or in the meantime, you want to transform another data source, you can definitely do that in there. You can indicate that things need to run in parallel there, just like you can do that in Azure Logic Apps as well. It's kind of similar, because there you do also process orchestration, and you can also indicate that you need things to do run in parallel. All right, let's see if we have another question. Another question is, how is Data Lake different from Hadoop file system? Ah, that's a very, very good question. Well, Data Lake store itself is based on the Hadoop file system itself. So HDFS, that's a Hadoop file system. So it runs on there, actually, as does Azure Storage as well. It does that as well. So it is all compatible with the Hadoop file system in that case. But Data Lake just provides a bit more of an abstraction over a Hadoop file system, where you have an API that can call it, where you have a couple of things that you can use to manage the data a bit more than you would be able to with the Hadoop file system. So that's basically the difference there. It's a management wrapper around Hadoop file system as your data lake store. Let's see, another question. Yeah. Let me do one more, and then I let Kazam take it over. So one more is, what is the best place to host a website in Azure Web Apps or Azure Container Service? Managing infrastructure is not a problem. My concern is about high scaling and cost optimization. Well, if you're looking for cost optimization, I would definitely go for an Azure Web App, because it is really not that expensive, and it's the cost differences between a web app or an Azure Container Service are quite irrelevant, really, for running such a small thing like a website, let's say. And the overhead that you save by not doing infrastructure management with a web app would definitely save you costs. You know, it just saves you hours, and it's just so much easier. And web apps are really meant for hosting websites, because they are web services as a service, like IIS, for instance. So I would definitely recommend using a web app there. All right, that's it. So I'll make sure that you guys get the slides as well. And you can reach me on Azure Barry at Twitter as well if you have any more questions, and I will try to answer them if I can, if I do know the answer. And that's it. Thank you all very much for your attention and for all of the questions. You guys have been a great audience. I hope you have learned anything from this. All right, Kazam, it's back to you.
Thank you, Barry. Thanks a lot. It was really an amazing and too informative session. And I believe everyone over here was the way they were shooting out the questions was really amazing. And thank you for answering them. I know it is already extended by 20 minutes. So, and in your so hectic schedule, you just answered it all. So thank you. Thanks a lot for presenting this session for us. And hope we'll come to know some more sessions from you for our community.
Yeah. It was great. I hope to be able to come back at some point.
Okay. Thank you, Barry. Thank you, everyone, for joining. I will share the recording for sure. And one last question, like everyone are asking for the deck which you presented. Yes, you like.
Maybe I can just send that to you and you can distribute it amongst everybody that attended.
That's great. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot.
All right. Will do.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.